Hello, my name is Frank Kuipers, and this is a Primary Academy webcast. Today we're going to address the question, why solvency can be a chance for an insurer, in spite of the immense and to some extent even absurd regulatory burden. Imagine you've just been promoted to be the CEO of an insurance company. What a feeling. Now you are empowered. And the first thing you've been asked to do is to make a decision. Okay, you've just been promoted to this position, and it's going to be a fairly simple decision. You just have to choose between two strategies. Just two. What I show here is where your company currently stands in terms of its profitability. Now, your planning department provided you with its profits expectations for the two strategies you have to choose from. Okay, the first strategy will increase your profit, and the second one is expected to decrease it. Now, which of the two strategies will you choose? This is not a trick question. Just answer for yourself or try to figure out what decision your board of directors would endorse. Maybe I could give you some time, or you press now on the pause button and you think, but don't think too long. I mean, what is the obvious answer to the question I have asked you? Well, most of the time, a board of directors would go for strategy number one. And they will argue that it enhances the value of the company, while strategy two destroys it. It reduces the value of the company. So far, so good. And that's quite all right. And with the information I gave you, this is probably the best you can do. And up to the end of the 20th century, this is actually how most insurers reasoned. However, although this was not a trick question, it might be considered as an ill-posed question today. Indeed, in the 21st century, most insurers have some idea of the risks they're taking, thanks to their regulatory solvency exercise. Even though for many this may remain a diffuse feeling inspired by some standard market formula, some insurers have a pretty concrete feeling about the risks they're taking, either because they implement an internal model or because they perform a realistic quantitative ORSA analysis. So, if we now add here the dimension of risk, we obtain a completely different picture and a much more complete one. So, indeed, strategy one, which increases the profitability, also increases the risk, and by quite a bit. While strategy two decreases the expected profitability and at the same time reduces the risk of the company. And if we are now comparing the two strategies at hand, not just of the expected profitabilities, this vertical dimension, but also at the same time of the horizontal dimension, actually, when you do this on the basis of the risk-adjusted capital, the RORAC, the picture is quite different. We see now that actually it is company one which destroys value because its RORAC is less, while strategy two, which gives you less profit, gives you also much less risk and hence enhances the value of the company. This RORAC, that is one measure of risk-adjusted profitability, it's defined as the quotient of the expected profit divided by the risk. This is a risk-adjusted key performance indicator that takes into account that high expected performances come together or are offset by a high volatility. This is nothing else but what we learned in our first quantitative finance lectures when we addressed the Markowitz model. Whatever tactical or strategic decision we want to take, we should always check to what extent it improves or worsens our current RORAC. Now, there's one region in this profit versus risk plot which we should avoid by all means. Well, clearly, you don't want to reduce your profit and at the same time increase your risk. And of course, where do we want to end up? Well, of course, is the region where you increase your profit and reduce your risk. And sounds like Santa Claus, but maybe it's not that unrealistic. But the usual quadrant of operations of an insurance company is the one where we assume the risk of our policyholders and where we obtain a reasonable remuneration for this. Now, there's one thing where you may want to ask the question, what is this quadrant? The one where we reduce our risk and forsake some of our profit. Well, this is exactly what happens when you buy reinsurance. You cede some of your own risk, and in return, the reinsurer will get some of the premium that you pay for him. Now, with this very simple machinery, you can start playing numerous smart thought experiments, which each come with their own expected profit and risk. And you can plot as dots on this Markowitz plot. Each of these dots represents a possible business plan, which may involve, for instance, a modified reinsurance program, or the acquisition of a new company, or the introduction of a new line of business, or whatever may occur to you that might improve the performance of your company. Remember, you are the CEO. Now, some of these business plans will have a better risk-adjusted performance. And if you plot sufficiently many of them, you will invariably see an efficient frontier emerging, which cannot be outperformed. And that is exactly what happens in the Markowitz model, which admittedly is a very simplistic portfolio model, but the phenomenon of the efficient frontier is totally general. Now here is how this efficient frontier could look like. And here is what it looks like in a realistic simulation of a stop-loss reinsurance program, where I explored how different choices of the priority and the limit affect the profitability on the vertical axis and the risk on the horizontal axis. Now, you can play the same game in general and submit it to your management board with the recommendation that whatever strategy they eventually choose to implement, it must lie on that efficient frontier. So, if they're much driven by profits, they may want to choose strategy A. Of course, they're going to take more risk. Strategy B is less risky, but on average promises less profit. And finally, the really risk-averse board might well choose strategy C. As you see, you can bring a lot of value to your management board in a very simple and intuitive way. And this way accounts for the risk appetite of your management board. And this is the real value added of solvency. Not the whole administrative and regulatory brimborium, but this here, the use of your risk model, because it makes you model exactly this risk dimension of your company. Now, you'd probably be quite ill-advised to use the Solvency II standard formula, which, after all, well, it results from market averages with wild guesses and loads of political compromises, and it is quite unlikely that it reflects anything close to the risks that you are taking. But with an internal model, which you may or may not have, or with an quantitative ORSA model, which you probably should have, well, you have the whole machinery to do everything we've discussed about and even much more. So that is why solvency is a chance for the insurance industry in general, and for you in particular. I hope you found this webcast useful And my colleagues behind the camera and myself would appreciate any feedback from you. Please don't hesitate contacting me if you wish to address any of the issues we discussed.